Hey, good morning all, and I know you got the timer here, so I'm gonna try to stay within my time too. You know, we did that drive, BMW drive yesterday, and they talked about, you know, you accelerate and you brake really hard. So I got more slides than I typically have here. So you're gonna see me accelerate, and you're gonna see me brake really hard as we get to the end. But you know, you heard Dr. Klasko last night. Definitely another world. Otherworldly type thinker. We were flying in from Tennessee from an engagement one time, and he asked me, "Hey, why'd you leave Kaiser Permanente and come to Jefferson?" And I was stumbling, going through sort of this broad explanation. And he goes, he takes my will book and he writes two words: impact factor. And I go, "Hey, sir, you know what? If I ever write a book, that's going to be the name of it: impact factor." But the impact factor is really just in terms of creating a transformational real estate and facilities team, which is one of three things that I was charged to do at Jefferson. One was to get their largest capital project off the ground. That's the specialty care pavilion, and it's off and going. The second was rationalization and real estate rationalization and realignment. Won't talk about that today. And then the third was really just creating a transformational real estate team for the organization. So, you know, sort of bedrocking to Dr. Klasko's talk, scaling to unscale. We scaled big, right? Brought in all this volume, and now the key is, you know, how do we extract all of that value through all of these mergers? The last of which was HPP, which is an acquisition of a health plan, and Einstein, which just closed on October the 4th. And so we're in the throes of getting this $750 million tower in place. That's Dr. Klasko and I, Philadelphia Business Journal, call that project the real estate deal of the year. But it's gotten other accolades. It got an accolade for supplier diversity. And so, you know, our ability to not only deliver this project and get this project started, but doing it in a way that sort of included the community, got the attention of the city council, which at one point was actually throwing rocks at us for not being very inclusive with the community. And it took us from being, you know, sort of the whipping boys and girls of the city to sort of the leaders in that arena. And so, you know, it's really just how do you create those synergies to deliver excellence in everything that you do. With the specialty care pavilion, it's gonna be about the fusion of technology, design, and the patient experience. And we're very fortunate to have John Scully as a direct advisor to Dr. Klasko in doing that. And so bringing these technologies together, modular hybrid walls, you know, integrated building systems, so having a smart infrastructure, sustainable buildings, along with a lot of the patient-facing technology, like ambient clinical technology, Nuance, which allows angel scribing, you know, without the provider sort of turning his back and typing in front of the patient. Those things that enhance that experience are just at the forefront of what we're doing. And so Dr. Klasko talks about this as the space station of the future. It's where we bridge home and the hospital. And in this particular case, it actually looks like a space station getting ready to take off. So pretty cool shot there. And just really some great, I'd say interiors and feel and operational efficiency that's going to define our brand going forward. But all right, the transformation, how do we get to the place where we can launch a project like that pretty effectively? And so the key was like transforming the organization. You know, our current state went 2.5 years ago when we started this journey. You know, we had 8 different facilities departments, all kind of doing their things, all on different scripts, multiple spreadsheets. You know, if you said, how do we do X, you got not 8 answers, sometimes you'd get 16 or 20. And so, you know, what we needed to do was to sort of develop a model where every dollar we spent enhanced brand, enhanced material readiness, continuity of operations, however you want to describe that, enhanced operational functionality, and drove down our total ownership costs. So we're going to really accelerate here. To do that, you know, you have to create that vision. What's that target? Where's that place that we're going? And so, quite frankly, I had done this for 1.5, 2 years at Kaiser Permanente, and had this particular slide ready to present and go there when I decided to jump over to Jefferson. So it's just changing the names and some of the statistics to protect the innocent, but it was the same issue. You know, how do you get multiple executives across a broad spectrum of functions to align to some common target and understanding of what they want to do in terms of facilities? And so once we created that target, it was about synthesizing every expenditure and every effort and every decision along that particular track. You need a framework to describe facilities lifecycle management. And so this is not the framework for a total facilities lifecycle management approach. It's a framework. There's certainly functions missing, but in broad spectrum, what we're trying to do is create a portfolio strategy that would inspire the organization as a whole, build alignment. We're doing that through sort of development of a guide specification that's being delivered by Gensler at the moment. We're doing other things like looking for a dynamic financial planning and modeling tool that'll help us understand, you know, the decision and the analytics in terms of the decisions we're making. Enterprise asset management, you know, taking that from a sort of, you know, who's on first, how do we do this, wherever, to sort of a more standard black box where everybody has the same expectation and understanding of how those decisions are made and how we rationalize our projects and our programs, and then refining our work execution, and then driving enterprise resource planning, which is the amalgamation of our data and the data and output metrics that we need with the technologies that we have. How do we bring those together, create performance reporting that can enable real-time understanding of how our portfolio is performing for our executive leadership. And our ability to do that has really enhanced the credibility that we have with our C-suite. We did this under five pillars. I really call it six because the other pillar is culture. And you know, the question that we asked in putting these together is, what are the common elements of a facilities management center of excellence? The reality, though, is that when I started laying this out with, you know, our HR department and ops and other departments within Jefferson, they're like, hey, this isn't a specifically facilities management construct. We could take this construct, you know, across the organization. And that helped us with the communication, building a lexicon of communications in terms of what we do from a facilities management standpoint in terms that anybody in the organization can understand. So this is, you know, I'm an engineer, so I got to have one complex slide up here, right? So this is it. You know, Whit would remember this as the galactic radiator that we had in the Navy, right? But it's really the same concept. You know, in the Navy, we went through regionalization, we went through base realignment and closure. That was all about rationalization and realignment of real estate. It was all about how do you build an efficient model for delivering your services. And so this is the model that we landed on. Won't go into any really depth, but what we drove was, hey guys, we got to spend at least 20 to 25% of our time on strategic, future-oriented, programmatic functions. Understanding that there's ops that we got to do every day. So the bottom half of that is about the ops, the day-to-day ops of how we execute, and the top half is about the future, right? So there's current ops, that's on the bottom, and there's future plans and future ops, that's the top. It's the way that we organize in the military to keep things going in a balanced way, and although I tried to leave the Navy totally behind, it was directly applicable here because it's what forced all of our executive leadership to start thinking more forward and future oriented. So we talked about things like digital transformation, and in our mind, digital transformation is sort of key to a lot of the discussions that we heard this morning in terms of workforce and the availability of folks to really carry us into the future and the need to leverage technology in a productive way in order to meet the needs of that future. Creating that workforce, and I kind of stole some of my thunder in a comment earlier today, so I won't go really deep into this, but it's really about, you know, in my philosophy, I hire for three things: capability, capacity, and coachability. Capability is, can you do this job that we need today? And do you have the ability to, or do you have the ability to do it? Capacity is, can you not only do this job, but do you have the capacity to grow and do more? Because what we do today is not necessarily what we're going to need for tomorrow. So I need employees today that are going to understand how to migrate and evolve into that future state. And coachability. Can I coach you in this environment? Which means for us, the last seven managers that and directors and EVs that we've brought into Jefferson, only two had prior healthcare experience. The other five did. All seven of them are killing it. The five who haven't had healthcare experience are really killing it because people are hearing them articulate ways of doing things that narrative has not existed in Jefferson before. So it's about, you know, rethinking how do we do our work? How do we distribute our work? And today's model, actually it was yesterday's model because we shifted this. Our PMs were doing everything. We had 16 PMs that had to do contracts administration, quality control, cost estimating, project management, program development. They were even in what we would call pre-award type activities. And so we were just stretching them very thin. And then you gotta ask yourself, what are the chances you can find 16 people who are experts in all of those types of functions? And so we're at this place where we have to naturally start to break off functions. And then for us, that meant creating a director of facilities contracts to treat contracts as a more professional type of capability. And then refocusing our project managers in those places where they could bring the most value. It also means that we're going from being more specific project focused in how we deliver to more programmatic. So as you see Jefferson evolve, our project managers will become program managers and we'll leverage the vendor community more and more to do project delivery, particularly on large complex efforts. So we've effected some of this transformation within our lines, and that's been our focus the last 2.5 years. But you know, you gotta feed the beast, right? And feeding the beast means getting good strategic signals from the organization. So we're leveraging a lot of the credibility that we've built through, you know, two currencies, performance currency, relationship currency. We have the advocacy of our board. We have the full advocacy of the CEO, the CFO, the CHRO. There's no decision that gets made in Jefferson now that doesn't include some call into somebody within real estate and facilities for a thumbs up. So I figured it's a huge success when the provost is about to go to the board with a huge project and he goes, hey, yo, Mitch, this isn't gonna fly unless you guys buy off on it. So let me make sure that I'm aligned with you. You know, we're, from a humble standpoint, I have to be aligned with them. But I think the trade-off here is they respect what we deliver and how we can position them for success from a real estate and facility standpoint. So we're getting a lot more calls of, we want to make sure that real estate and facilities is fully understands what we're trying to do so we have your full support going forward. Clasco's been really huge in pushing that, but so has our CFO. So hey, I'm gonna make my target here. This is my last slide. So a pathway to transformation. It begins with a sound vision. Where there is no vision, there is no hope. The people will perish. You gotta develop and recruit talent to execute that vision. And increasingly, that talent is outside the healthcare industry. It's in other industries that we need to pull into our industry to help us move forward. You need a plan of action that's communicated in the lexicon of the audience. So we need to be translators. Like I'm not a brick and mortar guy. I was talking to a donor the other day and we were talking about things and he goes, Mitch, I thought you were the real estate and facilities guy. And I go, I am. He's like, no, you're really the people guy, right? We got an ordinance to control development around our campus to protect two helipads. Through the city of Philadelphia in less than 12 months. No fanfare from the public, no violent pushback or anything of that sort, just by working the relationships, right? And speaking the lexicon of the audience that we were dealing with. And when people think about that, I mean, I'm a transplant to Philly, and they're like, you came to Philly and you got an ordinance passed in less than 12 months? A lot of it is translated, so I can't speak engineer speak to anybody in Jefferson, right? I've got to be able to speak that language that moves the particular entity that I'm dealing with. Requires the two forms of currency that I was talking about. It's about execution, right? So Witt will tell you, we come from a place where you execute or you die. That's could be literally and figuratively. So you got to execute to get a credibility. But once you get that credibility, it's about influence and advocacy. Originally, I had power and politics written up there. Jessica's heard this, or Julissa's heard this over and over. Politics and power are two things that we as engineers, architects, and folks in this, we kind of say, hey, you know, we're apolitical. But that's about how do you move the organization? How do you move the people in the organization? So that is an acumen that we have to pick up. And then it's about the stalwart values and guiding principles that we use to lead our day-to-day activities. So for Jefferson, it's putting people first. I work for the CFO, and when COVID hit, he's like, Mitch, we're not going to have any layoffs. And I was like, wait a minute, I'm talking to the CFO, and he's talking about not having layoffs. And there's a potential $300 million tsunami that's about to hit us. But he goes, we're going to get through April, and then we're going to get through May. We're going to go month by month, and the objective is that we don't have any layoffs, because if we're really putting people first, we got to take care of our own. Then it's about doing the right thing, and that was certainly the right thing to do in that arena. But here's what Clasco brings for everybody within the Jefferson family: being bold and thinking differently. Had he not spoken to you yesterday, I'd probably have to explain to you what that is. But he is definitely bold and different in his thinking. And so for us in the transformation arena, the transformation and creating that transformational real estate team, it has been an extreme, you know, dream, right? The situation where for example, our workforce, our ability to morph our workforce into that future 2030 model. And we did that initially saying we're going to do this staying within our FTEs and we're going to stay within our budget. But in the first iteration, our real estate team, in terms of how we grew it, brought back $13 million of value, real value that the CFO could see in a multiple of ways. You know, when I justify bringing in that new VP of real estate, it's like, I think this position is going to pay for itself twice over. It paid for itself probably 20 times over. So that type of credibility, really opened it up for us to now, we're actually growing from a staffing standpoint within real estate and facilities. The being bold and thinking differently is what Clasco's brought to Jefferson. It's going to be sorely missed when he leaves, but I think he's put the team in place to move us forward into that future. I think the lessons that we've learned in that journey, hopefully you guys have been able to pick up some of that in the last his session and maybe some in my session. But I think hopefully that if we start thinking about how we do business, how we engage, how we communicate, how we sort of lean forward and become co-equal business partners in our C-suites, we'll see a whole lot of progress going forward. That's it.